Hello, everybody. It's the Historical Gamer once again, and today we are returning to Suzerain, a political choose-your-own-adventure role-playing type visual novel game. That's a mouthful. This is a game that takes place in a fictional Cold War in a fictional country. It is pretty early in the game. We've only just had our initial inaugural ball. We've made our first decision in terms of a major infrastructure project, in which case we are building a highway system in the north of the country to sort of link up some impoverished areas that are primarily agricultural. The other option was a high-speed railway between Lochhaven and Holsord, which are sort of the two major cities and major economic hubs. My thought was, especially since we know Rumburg to the north is a threat, having better roadways might allow us to better defend ourselves. I guess we could also be creating better invasion routes. But I do know that one of the things that you possibly might want to do, or one of the options, is an alliance with Agnolia up here to the northeast. And so better roadways should help infrastructure and trade and other things like that way up here. So that was sort of the thought process. Also, these places are really poor, so bringing them up to standard, improving their economy, there's more upside. If you invest in a poor area, in theory, there's more potential upside than a place that is already relatively well off. We will see if that bears fruit, if that is true or not. But in this playthrough, we are going to be bad. Like, not that I'm going to try to do everything the worst possible thing, but I already, like, told my advisor and my VP in our first meeting, like, I want to reform the Constitution to kneecap the Supreme Court, but I also don't want to give up any power for myself. So, like, and they're already, like, looking at each other like, oh, shit, is this guy, like, he just wants to be a dictator. Like, that's all he wants, which, yes. But, yes. So let's go ahead and jump back into this. We were just recently at a ball where some political leader of an opposition group was assassinated. And now we have the communists and the fascists beginning to prepare for a war. We've seen a lot of weapons captured, a few isolated incidents of violence. So we've got sort of the two political extreme groups are looking to start killing folks. And that's probably also not good for the economy. Additionally, we did invest in a radio company, I guess. We put 2/3 of our personal fortune into it. Hopefully that pans out. I honestly have no recollection of whether that's a horrible investment or a good investment. I did save a little bit of money for myself. You can see up here, one, just in case something comes up where I need to invest my own cash. But we'll see. So let's go ahead and jump back in. The next stuff going on, we've got a dinner with the family at home, security briefing on threats against Sordland, and what's this? Read what report? Chief of Police Carl Grasser reports that two Blutish women, but then there's also the Blutish Freedom Front, which is a minority group that is trying to get civil rights in our country also. So you've got the communists, you've got the fascists, and then you've also got the oppressed minority group as well. So that's a thing. The arrested women have admitted their intention to attack the National Front rally at Seoul Square. The National Front are sort of the fascist right-wingers. With blah, 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 but rejected any connections to the BFF. Both claim they're acting alone. Okay. All right, so we have a security briefing on threats against Sordland and a dinner with the family at home. Let's do the dinner with the family first. After a long day at the palace, I was finally home. I thanked Serge and walked through the front gates, nodding at the two guards as I went by. Even as I turned the doorknob, I could hear Diana rushing down the stairs to greet me. I opened the door, and there she was, standing in front of me, with expectant eyes.
Papa, you're home!
There's my bright little daughter, there's my beautiful princess, lift her and hug. I guess there's my beautiful princess? I lifted Deanna up and hugged her while trying to put the keys in the tray next to the entrance. She was growing fast. Lifting her up was no longer as easy as it once was. Oof, that's enough. You're a big girl now. Where's your mother? How was school? I'm a caring father. I wish to know more about my child. Boring, I like my old school better. Put her down and her expression turned serious. Papa, are the bad men gone? There's only one bad man, Deanna, and yes, he's gone now. I will never let anyone hurt you ever. Yes, your papa took care of anything. I haven't done anything yet, so we'll say it was only one man and he is gone now. Okay, Papa. Deanna dashes down the hallway. Mama, Papa's here. Monica appeared next to the kitchen door. She was wearing an apron and holding a spatula in her hand. Deanna, what did I tell you? No running in the house. Yes, Mama. Monica approached me and kissed me on the cheek. A tantalizing smell wafted from the kitchen behind her. What do we have a cook for? How was your day, dear? I'm hungry. When's dinner? Darling, you shouldn't have. What do we have a cook for? I felt like going grocery shopping, just like old times. And besides, she can't make your favorite like I can. You mean... Yes, Lorcha. Lorcha was a Lockhaven specialty, usually reserved for special occasions. A rich seafood stew with a heady garlic and paprika kick. It was absolutely my favorite dish, especially paired with kebji, a potent unfiltered wine from Bergia. It's my lucky day. What's the occasion? No occasion, I just wanted to cheer everyone up a bit. Her smile faded as she lowered her voice so that Deanna wouldn't hear, especially after what happened at the ball. I'm worried, Anton, for you, for the children, and for the country. Deanna suddenly appeared next to us. Mama? Yes, sweetheart. I'm hungry. We can eat in a minute. Will you help me set the table? Anton, can you tell Franck to come down for dinner? He's been sulking in his room all day. Who's the bad man? The bad man killed some political person at a ball that we were at. Monica started taking out the plates while I was headed upstairs to fetch my son. Loud rock and roll music echoed down the hallway. Okay. With a faint hint of cigarette smoke. Okay. I will be the polite father and not intrude. I'll knock on the door. There's no response. Knock on the door again. Still no response. Bang on the door. The stair in Frank's room clicked off. All right, all right. He unlocked and opened the door. What do you want? Turn those records up louder next time, won't you? I don't think the neighbors heard. What neighbors? We're in the presidential palace, I'm assuming. Hand over those cigarettes and join your family for dinner. Food's ready. I gotta be a little bit stern with my fail son. Hand over those cigarettes and join your family for dinner. You smoke, don't you? I'm old enough to do what I want. As long as you live under my roof, kitty. I'm trying to quit that nasty habit. You ought to stop while you still can. Frank heaved a sigh, handed me the packet, and headed downstairs. I followed him to the living room. The table was prepared, and Monica was ladling food into the plates. Come on, have a seat. It won't be as tasty if it's cold. As we started eating, the room went quiet. Monica's cooking was delicious as ever, but I had the feeling that it wasn't the reason nobody spoke. She was the first to break the silence. Say, did you know they refurbished the grocery store? I didn't know if you remember the owner. He's been there every day for the past 30 years. Can you imagine doing the same job for so long? What if you were president for 20 years, for example? That's the plan, Monica. "20 years of this, I'd be dead." "Why not? We could live like kings." "Honestly, would that really be so bad?" "I'll play it soft. I'm not going to let her in too much. This game is called Suzerain Doom. It's currently on sale for 70% off on Steam." "Would that be so bad?" Monica measured me with her eyes for a moment. "Anyway, the grocer was really a nice person. He threw in some extra vegetables with my..." Frank suddenly slammed his hands on the table, rattling the plates. "So this is how it's gonna be. We're just gonna sit here like nothing happened. Dad, you could have been killed. Mom could have been killed. Any one of us could have died." "Okay. Frank, you know I would never let anything happen to you or Deanna, even if it cost me my life. And what would you have us do?" "Frank, and what would you have us do, Frank?" "I don't know. Talk about it, maybe." Fine. Let's talk about it. Sit down. Don't worry. We're going to be fine. That one doesn't really fit the mood there. I know it was a close call, but everything is under control. My security assured me that they took all the necessary steps. It was one rogue shooter, and we were not even the target. But what if we were? Frank, listen to your father. If your father says we don't need to worry, then we don't need to worry. You have to trust him. We all have to trust each other. Okay. Can you blame him? You weren't that far away from the assassination point. Goddamn right I can blame Frank. He's a goddamn fail son. Smoking cigarettes, listening to rock and roll music. At his age, I was out on the front lines on the border, escorting refugees back. He's still young. He should feel lucky he has a father who cared about him. I never had that. That's not really true. My dad put his career first, but I don't know that he didn't care about me. I don't know that we... That's what worries me. I made plenty of rash decisions when I was his age. Yep, that's true. Based on my backstory. You make plenty of rash decisions now, too. Frank's not the only one who's scared, Anton. All you need to worry about is putting more delicious dinner on the table. Okay. I promise if there truly is a threat to this family, you would be the first to know. She got up and stood behind me and massaged my shoulders for a moment before leaving me alone in the dining room. Had I been lying to Frank and Deanna? Was the threat to my family truly over? Time would tell. Okay. Any other updates? So we've got the other meeting at home. Looks like there's some other. Morelia expresses condolences for Circus. I don't know who any of these countries are, but they sure did add a lot more flavor. I don't know if they added a ton more content, but a lot more flavor at the international side of things. CSP faction spots like workers' rights. Okay. Doesn't she have a PhD? Best not to treat her in so. What did I do? All I told her was if I didn't treat her in a sexist way. All I did was tell her if there was a problem with the family, I'd let her know. But we are trying to be bad, Lord Tillion, so no promises we won't do some infidelity or something. I don't really know what the options are. I was a loving husband and a perfect ruler the first time around, and a good dad. You know, sometimes you gotta break away and see what the other story options are. All right, I arrived in the front doors leading the situation room. Today's security briefing was arranged in two parts, starting with internal matters and moving on to external matters after a short break. The Minister of the Interior, Lils Groff, and the Minister of Justice and Law, Nia Morgana, would join us for the first part of law enforcement briefing. For the second part, the Minister of Defense, Josef Lancia, would join with a few high-ranking officials, including Chief of the Armed Forces, Valken Kruger. Did Kruger write a telegram? Ha ha ha! I opened the door, and Lucia, Nia, and Lils rose from their seats. Still very early, Lord. Very, very early.
Sir.
Nod at Lucien and sat down. Everyone in the room sat down except for Lucien. He put on his glasses and went through the documents in front of him. Shortly after, he raised his head to address the attendees. Mr. President, ladies, we'll begin kicking off the meeting with the internal security briefing. I'm assuming everybody's already been over the agenda. We all have busy schedules, so without further ado, I'll jump into the first topic. As we feared, the political atmosphere has worsened. Reports around the country indicate that tensions are rising as we feared. What's the status on the Bernard Circus investigation? I've received the news this morning that the investigation into the murder of Bernard Circus has concluded. Please enlighten us. The more we know, the better. After further investigations and testimonies, we have confirmed the motive and also the events leading up to the shooting. A few days prior to the prior, members of the Red Youth initiated a violent attack on a Young Sword local leader in Yen. We believe the Young Swords then called for revenge, leading to the death of Mr. Circus. Since he often spoke against the Young Swords and nationalist sentiments in the assembly, he was a big target, not to mention his radical communist views.
He had it coming. He had it coming. He only had himself to blame.
I don't know how that song from Chicago goes. Radical. The Red Youth are clearly to blame since they triggered it. Political violence needs to stop. That seems to be stability. That's what I'm looking for here. Yes, we've kept it at bay for so long, but it seems that now there are new triggers. Leaz handed over the report and pointed at a highlighted section on the document. The investigation revealed a very troubling fact. The funding sources of the Red Youth have a clear link to United Kantana. Are you sure? Yes, we've found the cash trail. Several Red Youth members with ties to United Kantana have been detained, and information extracted from them point to a preparation for a communist uprising in Sordland. It isn't unusual for the superpowers to influence other nations, but I think this case is a little far-fetched. The left lacks popular support in Sordland. Nia eagerly lifted her hand. I motioned for her to speak. I went over the report in detail. It would be wrong to jump to conclusions about a clear foreign interference yet. United Kantana has humanitarian and cultural ties with many countries, including Sordland. I trust Miss Graf's judgment. United Kantana is clearly trying to expand its influence. I don't want to jump to conclusions immediately. We shouldn't create a crisis with them. Let's go to number two. Even if it's true, even if they are funding the revolutionaries, revealing that we know about it at this stage is not probably in our interest either. So let's follow the prudent course and not create a crisis with them yet, especially until we've actually met with anyone else who can help us, like the U.S.-based country. Nearly three decades ago, they funded General Rickard and tried to establish a communist dictatorship of our country. If it was not for Colonel Soul, we would have seen the real crisis. Wasn't Soul a command economy guy, though? I assumed he was more of a leftist, but I honestly don't remember the description of him. Our police chief, Carl Grieser, has linked the funding channel to the United Kantana Consulate in Benifi. As we know, the enemies of Sordland are many, but we also have threats inside the country. As the government, we have all the power to deal with any threat. Our country always had issues. This is part of our job. We need to remain vigilant. If we give up essential freedoms to purchase temporary security, we deserve neither freedoms nor security. I've heard that quote before. This is debatable, but yes, we know what more security and surveillance caused to this country under President Soul. Let's not forget that President Soul, God bless him, brought stability after a long period of bloodshed and chaos. But moving on. Our highest internal threat comes from the estimated 20,000-strong Blutish Freedom Front, led by the imprisoned Dwelin R. They are a banned political organization, now a militant force that is trying to incite racial violence. What do the Bloods have to do with anything that we were talking about? They make a lot of noise, but have little substance. A barking dog doesn't bite. Are they supported by our Blutish citizens? Are they cooperating with any Blutish political organizations? They make a lot of noise, but have little substance. A barking dog does not bite. It may seem that way from the outside, but police intelligence shows real potential for them to become dangerous. Our intelligence intercepted two crates filled with weapons close to the Rumburg border. They were filled with military-grade KA-74s. We expect that more have been smuggled in. A group of Bloods was caught with these guns at a checkpoint not far away. The governor of Bergia, Felix Braun, is already taking the necessary measures to counter the threat. Rumburg has been acting aggressively in the region for a long time. I'm not surprised they'd attempt to weaponize the Blutish people against us. This is worrying. Very worrying. Can we make any direct correlations between the BFF and Rumburg? It was expected that Rumburg would undermine us, but this is too far. We need to keep a level head with Rumburg. They're looking for reasons to take action. We can't let anyone meddle. Can we make any direct correlations between the BFF and Rumberg? Not yet, but we have suspected that we have suspects that indicate such a correlation. This is grave news, but we must be careful not to stoke the fires of anti-Bluetooth sentiment. Unfortunately, Governor Braun is directly causing the tensions to increase with his increasingly anti-Blutish stance. I must remind you, Governor Braun is directly responsible for the arrest of Dwellin Arg, the previous leader of the BFF. It is true that his methods can be extreme at times, but it was his policies that kept the region peaceful over the last decade. Man, nothing to do with this game, but the Cubs game is nuts. It's 20-9 in the ninth inning. It's like a freaking football game. Okay. Anyway, he's misusing the powers given to him by Tarquin Sol. The insane authority of the governor is surely a root cause. It would be very difficult to revoke the special status of Barragea under the current circumstances, Miss Morgana. The president no longer had the authority that Tarquin Sol enjoyed. For now, yes. But with enough justification for it, it would be possible. Anyway, we'll be discussing this at a later time. Tell me more about the special zone. As you know, Barragea was given a special status by Tarquin Sol after the full-scale uprising by the BFF against the Swordish government in 35. Those couple of years were disastrous for Barragea, Dwellin, Arg, and the BFF. Declared war on us, openly attacking our people and occupied entire cities. It was a massive uprising, but I like to point out that the longest time they were in control of a city was 2 weeks. I wouldn't call that an occupation. Despite the arrest of Dwellin Arg in 44, the BFF ceasing its activities, the special status of the region were never revoked. So they're kind of like an autonomous zone then, I guess. Today's special zone of Barragea gives the governor insane authority. He was in trouble with the law before. Okay, so Barragea is basically an autonomous zone, presumably set up to give the Blutish people some element of self-governance and freedom. And as a result, the governor of the province has considerably more authority than other governors, I'm assuming. Yeah, I think a lot of games like this would be interesting, Vargas, like of a lot of different settings. There's not enough like good storytelling type games like this, even though it's like not, you know, strictly speaking, what a lot of people think of when they think of a strategy game. The discrimination Barragea suffers is maddening. We should find a way to revoke the special status of Barragea one way or the other. I'd rather not disturb the status quo while we're facing all these threats. We must reverse the situation. It's absurd that the Minister of the Interior doesn't have full control over Barragea. Governor Braun, his special powers deserve credit for the current peace in the region. Huh. So, do we want to institute a power struggle with this guy? I also don't know that I trust Lil's Graf, like, bringing her over this other group. Is there really peace there, though, now? I'll go with one. It feels like it's not totally in Leal's camp. Nia will probably appreciate it. The gang violence that is threatening Nargis and Agna regions, two prominent organized crime families, are at war. The potential for bloodshed is real. Which two crime families? One is known as the Cornelli, and the other is the Skinner Cartel. They used to be allies until a recent disagreement. Both are active in the cities of Narbal and Estord. I trust you can handle it. I'm doing my best, sir. I shall be honest with you. With our current capabilities, we may not be able to prevent the further arming of separatists while maintaining order in Barragea and Argosimla. If law enforcement's budget isn't increased, I can't be fully responsible for what happens. Our police units are spread thin as it is. In light of this information, I might increase the law enforcement budget. You'll do your job, whatever happens. Don't come to me with excuses. I would rather increase the military budget. I might. This doesn't commit me to anything. I might. I wish you'd stop using the word thugs, Leals. The real problem is corruption, which is fueling the gang violence and is very likely the reason why these weapons are smuggled in. A higher budget could help us end that. These threats seem more direct than a few bribes. Valid points. Corruption is the root of all evil, after all. These threats seem more direct than a few bribes. They are, and they need the attention they can get from our administration. I didn't even get the sense that they were arguing. Okay. Thank you for the overview. All right, so the military folks are coming on in now.
Mr. President, Joseph, welcome.
I don't know why my accent changed.
I've brought General Kruger with me due to the escalation on our borders.
Okay. Strong jaw with sharp cheekbones. His tall stature, uniform medals combined with his deep, intense stare made him look threatening. He was in his 70s, yet he had a bulky body that was a result of his commando training. Not only was he the second most decorated officer in Sordland, he was also the longest serving. I'm not going to salute him. I'm the president. He salutes me.
General Kruger, Mr. President, it's an honor.
That's not that strong of a jaw. Yosef tapped his foot impatiently. He seemed uneasy with the presence of another high-ranking officer in the room.
Gentlemen, thanks for coming to this significant gathering. Let us begin. Yosef and Valken took their seats at the table while the rest of us stood by the door.
Mr. President, the situation at the western and northern borders toward Rumburg is very tense. We are observing deployments of divisions closer to our border.
Rumburg has been acting increasingly expansionist in the past decade and also interfered in Agnolia, but now they have turned their sights on us.
This concerns me very much. We're observing these areas actively. Our contingency plans are ready.
It seems like they want to increase the pressure both externally and internally.
Mr. President, if I may.
Please, General.
The picture is becoming clearer. The latest information from the interior about the weapons caches, and now there is an active military buildup close to our border. The entire situation was analyzed by a general staff, and our prediction is a future territorial incursion by Rumburg.
Let them come. We will give them hell. Ah!
Okay, maybe that's a little too bellicose. I have complete trust in the general staff.
We will not let you down, Mr. President. The general staff is composed of the smartest military individuals. I require an increase in the military budget to enlist more soldiers. Only then can we stand strong against our enemies. The enlarged armed forces will hold them at bay.
Valken is right. We do need an increase in the military budget, although we don't see eye to eye on exactly how to spend the budget. That much we agree on.
I have my concerns about Rumburg, too. We need strong allies to withstand such a superior power. They are our nemesis.
That is an understatement. Times are changing and war is coming, Mr. President. Whether we like it or not, we must be prepared.
Don't forget that during the election you promised to focus on the military. I expect that word to be kept for the defense of our nation.
I am a man of my word, Yusuf.
Of course you are, and that's why I follow you, Mr. President.
The only way we can guarantee the national survival is through a more capable military force against Rumburg. Our country hasn't fallen to any invading force for 200 years.
You cannot let this happen, Mr. President.
We should find regional allies like Vagsland or Lepesia to deter Rumburg. There are several options on the table.
Rumburg wouldn't attack any nation allied with any superpower.
Sordland must stand on its own 2 feet and be able to defend itself.
These options should be considered.
They could be considered, but why pander to others when we can solve these issues ourselves?
We have no friends outside these borders.
Everyone fell silent when a soldier entered the room and yet let Yosef know that a call had come through from the ministry.
A few minutes later, he entered the room. His expression had changed.
Mr. President, there has been a Rumburgian military activity close to the Narbal border.
I just spoke with the local commander.
Falcon, we should go to the Ministry and get further updates from our branches.
Understood. Raising military readiness is the first call of action. If there truly is an extraordinary attempt, we will relay it to you immediately. We wait for further orders, Mr. President.
Remain calm. Make sure not to escalate things further. Nobody wants a war. Make sure they know we are observant and ready.
We're not really ready, though, are we? I don't think we are.
Remain calm. Nobody wants a war.
We'll exercise utmost caution, Mr. President.
Hail Sordland! Hail!
Okay. Rumberg was already testing us, and reports from the interior indicated interference inside our borders. Communist, nationalist, blutish rebels, Rumberg expansionism. What was next? Sordland had always been a key piece in the chessboard of the global rivalry between Arcasia and the United Cantana. But in the recent years, there was no such aggression from Rumberg. Not at these levels, at least. All it takes is one tiny spark to start the flame of war.
Rumberg had decided to close their consulate in Lochhaven.
Well, that's not good. Did I see something about a nationwide revolt?
Arcasian Treaty Organization.
Ooh, Arcasia developing the first ICBM. Hell yeah, brothers.
The Missile 4, an intercontinental ballistic missile of significant power and range. The Missile 4, with its estimated strike range spanning thousands of kilometers, represents a major leap in Arcasian military technology. Its precise targeting system allows for the destruction of targets at long distances, thereby escalating the potential that Arcasia poses to territories well beyond the borders of Western Maricopa.
I want to know what the range and the payload of this missile is. Give me those details. That's the kind of stuff I care about.
Not that it matters in any way for the game, but I do want to know.
United Cantana Consulate helped protesters. What the fuck?
Around midnight, youth protesters clashed with young swords at the Vesorn City Center, resulting in many injuries. The counter-protesters were cornered in front of the United Cantana Consulate after they were pushed back by the police. The diplomatic mission opened its doors, and the Red Youth members escaped inside. The police are still waiting outside the building for the return of the Red Youth members.
Pieces of shit. They're directly interfering in our domestic affairs.
I can't fight them, though. They're a freaking superpower, and I certainly can't fight them while I'm fighting Rumberg.
Some new religion is rising in the rural areas. Okay. Thanks for the follow, HF.
Nationwide revolt. The country is currently facing widespread violent protests as a result of recent events. The situation has become increasingly tense. If it's not contained, it could cause significant harm to the country's economy and stability. Security forces are working tirelessly to restore order and prevent further violence.
Sordland is facing noticeable pressure from Rumberg, demonstrated by the readiness of diplomatics or reduction of diplomatic staff and the closure of key consulate. The development is expected to significantly impact Sordland's diplomatic relations with Rumberg, potentially leading to a further deterioration.
Thanks for the follow, Brick.
Yeah, it is a very interesting game. Okay, react to the unrest. End of day at the Maroon Palace. Let's do the react unrest first.
The political situation around the country has escalated. Chief strategist Lucien Gall has prepared several action plans that we can execute. What will we do to address the intensifying political climate? Call for restraint on national television. Visit the affected towns in person. Label all protesters as traitors. Expand the police by deploying all recruits in training. Reject the plans.
Let's call for restraint on national television. I don't want to send out untrained police officers to start some kind of Kent State.
And I don't want to, like, if we call these freaking people traitors, then that's not going to do any good either.
We need to appeal to their reasonability.
I guess I'm not doing a good job of being a dictator to some extent. I need to be more violent.
Sometimes I think I let my pragmatism get in the way. Okay. What was that last one? Protest and Grunny. Underhaul construction once again, number one. Okay. Gang violence claims a young girl's life. Political chaos. And Rumberg closes concert. Okay. Well, end the day at the Maroon Palace. It was late in the evening. The Maroon Palace was finally getting somewhat quiet when I returned to my office at the top. I eagerly approached my chair and sprawled out onto it. It had been an exhausting day, just like every day since I took office. Light a cigarette, pour some whiskey, lean back and relax, prepare to go home. Pour some whiskey. It felt like the best salve after a long day's work. I glanced down out the window and saw Serge and the guards waiting for me by the main gate. I heard a couple of knocks on the door. My secretary, Livia Suno, entered. Mr. President, Mr. Tusk is here to see you. You have a meeting with the Lothberg spokesman. I'm so sorry for not giving you proper notice. Don't worry about it. Thank you for your understanding. After a moment, Mr. Tusk swaggered into the room. I'd met Sordland's most prominent businessman once or twice, but never alone. Thanks for the resub, Ven. Appreciate it. You're so bad at the game, but love it. I did great the first time, but we're deliberately trying to be bad now, so we'll see how that goes. He had large jowls and a blindingly shiny shoes and the air of someone who was used to getting his way. Anything to drink, Mr. Tusk? Water? Whiskey? Cognac, but preferably from before you were born, sweetheart. I'll check the supply room. Livia backed out of the office, shooting me an apologetic look as she did so. Walter hung up his hat, which I could see was lined with mink. He fixed me with a long, hard stare, then broke into a toothy grin. Good evening, Mr. President. I'm here to congratulate you. What the hell? My accents are all over the place. That's why I could never be a role-playing streamer, because I change everything. All the time. There's no consistency. My business partners and I wish you a successful term as the leader of our nation. Thank you, Mr. Tusk. I had no chance to say this at the ball with all the panic, but we are very much looking forward to working with you. Yes, yes, all this foreplay. Just get to your point. I'd like to build a profitable relationship between us. That being said, there are some concerns of mine and the people I represent, which I would like to take this opportunity to clear up. I'm listening. The ruined state of the economy in Sordland has influenced everyone. The recession hit us all hard. Walter pulled out a box of cigars from his jacket. I had these brought from Lespasia, the best cigars on the whole continent. Would you like to try one? Sure. I grabbed one out of the pack. Walter lit it up with his large engraved lighter. Now we're talking, a man who knows pleasure and business. Well, I was already drinking some whiskey, so there's no harm in having a smoke. Walter grabbed himself a cigar and lit it up as well. We looked out at the city scenery as we both puffed away. I heard that you purchased stock from Ardmine Industries in Arcasia. Smart buy. They're developing new gadgets that are going to be profitable. With risk comes reward. I expect a very good return on investment. Spend money to make money, they say. Let's see if it holds true. I figured, why not take the chance? With risk comes reward. I expect a very good return on the investment. You have a keen eye for business. I'll buy a couple thousand shares too. Oh no, now we've gone from, this is insider trading. This is insider trading. Now he's going to prop the price of the stock up by buying a bunch of stock himself. Or he'll short it to fuck us if we don't give him what he wants. I'll buy a couple thousand shares too to expand my portfolio. Hope the investments pay off for both of us. You're having a good start to the term for sure, besides the recent troubles. Glad that you decided to promote the free market, which is the only thing that can get us out of this mess. It's good that we think alike on this matter. I'll play back with some sugar back myself. To a closer relationship, then. One that will bring Sordland out of crippling recession. The highway investment was a good call, but there was more to gain in the high-speed rail, especially for business logistics. I don't want to disclose our intentions to an outsider. The Eglin region was in dire need of investments. The most important goal is to divert investments where more profit can be made for the treasury. We can be close allies. The group can help you get Sordland out of the recession, which will be key to solve in your term. We could even determine your re-election. Let's start with a gesture of goodwill. Soon the investment project contract will be awarded to one of the three main contenders. He pulled a check out of his pocket and slid it toward me on the table. My personal bank details were listed on it with a deposit of 500,000 Swordish Ren ready to be transferred. This was 6 months of a president's salary. If the contract were somehow awarded to Underhill Construction, they would not only work harder and deliver, but also do it on time. What do you think, Mr. Rayne? Would that be good? There was a noise by the door, and Livia Suno was standing there holding a tray with a bottle and two glasses. I'm so sorry, Mr. Tusk, but all I could find was 1942 Sauvignon. I hope that's acceptable. She quickly put the tray on my desk and walked out. Tusk eyed her as she left. Remind me to visit your office more often. Tusk, you're a pig. Now, where were we? Do we have a deal? Indeed, Mr. Tusk, I'm looking forward to our future transactions. Take the bribe. We know you can do better than that amount. I'll make my own decisions.
Did you just try to bribe the president? Oh, my God.
I feel like taking the bribe is a bad idea.
What if I say no? We both know you can do better than that. You're right about that. I'll make this my final offer.
1,000,000 Swordish Ren.
Holy Batoli. Oh my God, that's a year's salary. Do we start the term off with corruption?
Free market, baby.
I don't know if this is really free market. Take it, Llewellyn. Oh, boy. I don't know what to do. Charcoal, are you still around? I need my mod's advice. My main concern is, I think, and here's where my head is at. I think what's going to happen is when we meet with the media conglomerate, they're going to want something too. And I worry if I commit to this guy now, it'll prevent me from committing to the media group. And I think the media group is going to be more important to making sure that if there is corruption, people don't find out about it. So I think we'll go with number two, maybe. Maybe. Well, Hunter isn't the president, unjust. I am. My other fear is that, like, I don't want to play too much based on current knowledge, but Livia's been in here in and out. Like I think she might be listening because she's been in and out like through this conversation. And I don't want my secretary to come back with a better offer. We'll be in touch. I still think this was a good start for a beneficial partnership in the future. Okay, good. So it doesn't look like I burned any bridges. And we didn't commit to anything. Although it could be bad if someone finds out that I was asking for more money. Oh, I almost forgot. Please say hello to Mr. Cortani for me. He smiled. Have a good evening, Mr. President. Walter stood up and grabbed his jacket and made his way toward the door. He closed the door behind me. I gathered my things and prepared to head home. As I walked out, Livia stood there covering up her typewriter for the evening. If I may be so bold, Mr. President, did you accept his offer? I knew it! I knew she'd be listening. Of course I did. How could you even ask me that? Do not ever speak about it again. You didn't see anything. That is absolutely none of your business. Of course I didn't. The other girls have told me about all kinds of dealings that went on during the Alfonso administration. I wasn't sure if you were that kind of president. Say you didn't let her throw herself under the bus. Too late. I didn't. Don't worry your pretty head about it. I most certainly am not. She and I took a moment to look over the lights of the city before heading to the elevators. At least I'm not that kind of president yet. I'm just covering my own ass for now. Finalizing the H3 highway contract. Okay, so we've still got that situation. Local police working with nationalists. One of our agents acting as a young sword member had an encounter with two members of the local police force in Arcadia. According to the report, police tried to bribe the agent and burn down a store that belonged to known communist. Okay. Goddamn corrupt police officers. The Ministry of Defense reports that the situation along the border is getting tense. Rumberg's Southern Army was sighted training close to our borders. They did not respond after we issued a radio message.
Increase the DEFCON level.
Is there anything else outside of here? What's going on over here?
The Grand Duchy of Pales.
In a formal address, the Grand Duke Axel Reinhardt of Pales issued a cautionary statement regarding recent Rizian activities. Rizia, the future DLC that has not come out yet. The activities the Grand Duke expressed increased concern over the intensifying border dispute and clashes over territorial waters and gas fields. Asserting Pale's sovereignty, he called for respect for international laws and peaceful dialogue to prevent further escalation. He urged the Alliance of Nations to mediate the situation, emphasizing the potential risks this tension could cause to regional stability, or pose to regional stability. Okay. All right, so H3 highway contracts. We've got three decisions coming up. But with that being said, we've been going for over 45 minutes here today, so we're going to go ahead and wrap this episode up here. We will pick up next time with some key economic decisions and some foreign policy stuff, as well as some business shenanigans in our next episode. I wonder if I should have taken the bribe. $1 million would go a long way. I'm sure my wife would be proud. But we didn't take the bribe, and so, yeah. Anyway, guys, hope you guys enjoyed the video. Let me know your thoughts below. And until next time, this is the Historical Gamer saying thank you for watching, and I'm out.